So, we've had a pretty decent sample size of every team since the trade deadline, and that's made me want to talk about two specific organizations. I don't want to spoil anything yet, so if you're new around here, or haven't done so yet, please like and subscribe to help the channel grow, but let's just get this video started. Now, I didn't say anything in the intro, but the haul the Brooklyn Nets got in return for KD has been really impressive, and that's made me realize that this blockbuster trade wasn't uneven at all. Mikal Bridges, he's had the chance to be a number one option for the first time in his career, and to a lot of people's surprise, including mine, don't get me wrong, that's turned him into a baby Durant type, really efficient scorer. I mean, since the deadline, he's in the top 20 for both points and 3-point percentage of guys that played over 5 games and shot 4 or more threes. That eliminates guys like KD, who didn't put up the numbers for a consistent period of time, but we're gonna get into that later. Not to mention, the two additions they made, referring to Bridges and Cam Johnson, that really solidified the Nets defensively. The all-new addition starting lineup, other than Nicholas Claxton, so Spencer Dinwiddie, Mikhail, DFS, and Cam, they have one of the best defensive ratings out of all commonly seen lineups. That's resulted in them actually holding their playoff spot. However, although I bet the organization and fans would enjoy a postseason run, and don't get me wrong, I think they're gonna get it, the Nets are set up really well for the future. Genuinely speaking, Mikhail can become the face of this franchise, or at least an attractive piece to any free agents. They have a lot of young talent, and for what it's worth, the Kyrie Irving trade gave them two championship contending role players. That's in addition to the 4 firsts they got from Phoenix, and that pick swap, and the first they got from Dallas. You really have to give credit to the Nets organization for getting out of a rough situation, where two of the league's best players request trades, and they managed to get a lot out of it. Now, for the Kevin Durant side of the deal, we all know that he fit into the Suns lineup seamlessly, and when he comes back from injury, that team is gonna have a couple shots at winning the title, like they're expected to do. But on paper right now, before the playoffs happen, it looks as if Phoenix got their money's worth when trading for KD. They just have to hope he can stay healthy for long enough. Two of the most fun teams to watch this season have been surprisingly the Kings and the Pacers when completely healthy. These two teams, they swapped all-stars last season, and it's been a blessing for both sides. Domantas Sabonis, he's having the best season of his career undoubtedly, and his partnership with De'Aaron Fox, it's made Sacramento the possible second seed, but it looks like their floor is third. On Indiana's side, they got in return for Sabonis what looks like a future star. Tyrese could easily get the assist title. I mean, it's right there for the taking. He's just 0.4 assists behind James Harden, and keep in mind, he doesn't have anyone like Joel Embiid to pass to. Buddy Hield, he's found his groove consistently from three for the first time in a while, and that's made this Pacers duo one of the sharpest from the perimeter in the league. No, they're probably not making the play-in, much less the playoffs, but that's kind of because Haliburton got injured. I mean, they were the sixth seed the day he went down, so the future is bright for both teams that were part of this deal. At the beginning of 2019, we witnessed Anthony Davis fed up with the Pelicans, but New Orleans as a franchise, they wanted to make sure whatever package they were dealing AD in would be worthwhile. Nowadays, almost 4 years removed from that deal, there's still people that think the Lakers lost, just because of how injury-prone Davis can be. But in my eyes, there's no way they got the bad side of the trade, since they won the championship in that first year. If you really think about it, AD's second and third year with Los Angeles, those two seasons are kind of sandwiched in between one extremely good and another that looks to be really promising. That year they won the championship, Davis was completely healthy, and this season, he's the healthiest that he's been since the Lakers left the bubble. I mean, they were up by 40 last night in a game that he scored 35 in, with 17 boards. Coincidentally against his former team, which we'll talk about soon. This is the first time in a while that the Lakers have looked like an actual contender. I honestly think that if they started the year with this roster, they would have been a top 3 seed by now. And don't try and tell me that LeBron is the problem, because he isn't. Ever since the Lakers pulled the trigger on their biggest target at the time, they've had championship aspirations 4 out of 4 years, actually won one, and now have a chance to do so again. As for the Pelicans, they've used the trade as a solid catalyst for a brand new roster. Lonzo and Josh Hart are both gone, but Brandon Ingram is one of the best scorers in the league, and they also used their latest pick from the Lakers to get Dyson Daniels, who's been really solid. New Orleans could have even gotten Wembanyama, the way the Lakers were playing at the beginning of the season. It's tough to tell now because they've slipped down so far, but the Pelicans were a one seed not too long ago, and that was with only Zion and no BI, so imagine how scary the Pels could be if both of them played together consistently. The last trade that I wanted to mention pretty briefly is actually Kawhi to the Raptors. There's no need to talk about Toronto's side of the deal, because Kawhi gifted them the only championship in franchise history and gave them his best playoffs ever. But what I wanted to talk about was actually the Spurs, because although they lost their franchise player, they really did the best they could have in that situation. Kawhi wanted out of San Antonio, so something in return was better than nothing. They got two solid seasons of DeMar DeRozan that kept their playoff hopes alive. And they also rose Jakob Poeltl's stock to the point that they gave him back to Toronto for a first rounder. But what sticks out the most in this deal was the protected first Toronto gave the Spurs. Since they won the finals, that protection didn't come into effect, and San Antonio got Keldon Johnson with the 29th pick. He's gradually developed as a player in these 4 years under Pop, and he looks like he'll be one of the main pieces during and post this rebuild. Thank you guys for watching, I really appreciate it, like always. Comment down below the best trade that your favorite team ever made. And also, hit like and subscribe if you haven't already, because it really helps me out. But anyways, I'll see you all in the next one.